Good afternoon and welcome to the Capital Investment Committee meeting of October 28th, 2021. We will have a roll call. Alderman Blanton.
Here.
Alderman Berger, absent. Alderman McClendon, absent. Alderman Martin, present. All right, since we don't have a quorum today, we will defer the minutes to December the 9th, the CIC meeting of December 9th. And we will not vote on that.
Sounds good to me.
What?
Sounds good to me.
Okay. All right. Item number two, we will discuss these items, but they will be, most of them will be deferred until the votes to November the 9th on new business. But we will discuss them here today.
The only other thing I'd ask is if you see something you want,
do you think that warrants a discussion at work session? We could also accommodate that too. So as you're going through these items and you think this could be a worthy discussion on work session, that could be an option as well on the night.
Well, and so, what I would say about that is, depending on how long that agenda is, yeah. I think, I mean, even if you look at item number two, which we're fixing to talk about, that's a great rudimentary thing for our new aldermen to mm-hmm. kind of be able to see mm-hmm. how that works. So I think some of these will probably be easy to move to new business, but then there's others that I think might
others they may want to discuss. So just have that in mind. Let us know
sure.
if you have a preference on that.
All right, item two, discussion of traffic calming devices to be installed on Boyd Mill Avenue between 11th Avenue North and Culberson Boulevard.
So,
and I'm assuming that any one of the three of our distinguished gentlemen would like to discuss that for us.
I will give it a shot, and Adam and Jonathan can certainly chime in. Adam did most of the work associated with this. So we went through the neighborhood traffic calming program. They did a petition. Out of 47 property owners, 34 signed. So that's a very positive response to install.
Talk into that, please.
To install speed humps on this roadway. The concern we have is that this isn't a typical residential subdivision type street. It is very residential, but it's also used, you know, for cut through to get to the park, to get to downtown, to get to the school system. So that's a little bit of a concern. However, they did meet the criteria associated with speed, and they did meet the criteria associated with the traffic volume. The traffic volume, the ADT was 1,693. So there's 1,693 vehicles that drive on this road per day. And so it's a little bit concerning to put three speed humps on there because you're only truly doing a cross section, or we typically will only look at a zone of influence of those adjacent neighbors that are right along the section of Boyd Mill Avenue. And from them, we got a very, very positive response to move forward with speed bumps. And so that's ultimately what we're recommending. But that doesn't necessarily take into consideration all the citizens that do cut through this area. So while the installation of the speed humps is supported by our neighborhood traffic calming program and recommended for approval, there could be a significant number of people that also that cut through, turn around and call and complain. So we just really wanted to bring it to y'all and get your feedback. Ultimately, we would like this to go to the work session for the full board to discuss it.
Would you like to do that? You want to comment?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I mean, we're here.
Yes.
Well.
Yes.
So, and remind me. Well, no, you won't remind me because I'm going to argue with you. So, when we come up to the full board. So, I grew up on Alexander Drive, which is Westfield. Take a right on Alexander. And my whole entire youth and even today, people still cut through Westfield, Alexander to get to Del Rio to get mm-hmm. to Kroger. So, I was surprised, I don't know how long ago those speed humps were put in there, but to me, it's an analogy of if those people in Westfield Estates and Idlewood had wanted those, which I'm sure they did, they're there, it's probably a bigger cut through for 96 West going to Kroger and all those other areas than this would be. So I hear what you're saying about it being a bypass, but the same thing was done across 96 in Westfield and Idlewood, and to me, it's a good comp.
Yeah, and ultimately, we're just looking for your feedback and kind of warning you of the pros and cons. It's supported by our neighborhood traffic calming program, so
gotcha.
We have no objections to putting it in, but it could result in other people calling to complain that use it as a cut-through.
Sure.
I would like to say that the people that are complaining, and that you will get complaints, if they would have slowed down, we wouldn't have had to have the speed bumps if they'd slowed down to start with. So, you know, I think the neighbors want it for their street. They deserve it. And I would imagine that there will be other streets that will request this too. So I hope you will continue to
and ultimately
respond to them.
We're going to bring it to work session just to make sure we have positive feedback from the board, but we're not necessarily asking you to vote on it because it does comply with the neighborhood traffic calming program. Assuming there's no major objections at the board level, we would go ahead and work with our street department on the installation of it. And then just kind of as a reminder, the only way to remove them would be to go back through that process. And like always, and Adam's very good about doing this, and our talk team is, they will study it before, which is completed, and they will also evaluate it afterward to make sure that it's meeting the goals and objectives of our program.
So my only other concern, just because of the, I don't know the word, Adam, you can tell me, the way the road goes like this, what do you call that?
It's the vertical curvature of the roadway.
Yeah, I mean, I think we need to be really, and I'm sure your engineers, you would think that you want to make sure that those bumps are not where they're like, oh, you know what I mean? Where you can kind of...
Yeah, we do. We want to check sight distance of those bumps where you can see them coming up. And we'll put warning signs up with those that let you know they're coming and do striping changes that let you know they're coming.
And Adam even went above and beyond and got all the property owners where the bumps are going to be, the speed humps are going to be, to sign off on the location of it well. So he's done a great job with this.
I imagine the residents that live there will be thrilled to death to have it. And there really are some other streets that need it. I don't know whether they would qualify. I think they would if the neighbors got behind it. But that's great. I'm glad that's coming up before the rest of you.
Stop it.
And this is one of the first years, I'll add on, that we've had a larger dedicated budget for traffic calming. So one of the things you'll see, as in this presentation, some of the larger traffic calming requests, sometimes there are simple ones where it's just simple signage or a simple issue that will, as long as they comply with our manual, we'll just go out and do, we'll have those installed and we'll be done with them. Some of the larger ones, such as this, that affect a longer street, a larger area, we'll bring those back periodically to let the board see and give input on and just let y'all see those and kind of bless those as they go through. Even though they comply with our program and the program allows us to install those, we do want to give y'all an opportunity to provide input on those and just give you the heads up that those are going in case you do get complaints on those, to let you know that they are going in. But this is very similar, and you mentioned the correct project. It was Alexander and Westfield going through there, very similar to that one. And I think Adam even mentioned that in his memo, was that we did a phased approach to that one where we did the first ones on Westfield itself and considered Alexander a second phase of that. And I think the residents did appreciate that one very much. And this one is very similar in that nature, where we're doing the rubberized humps that can be removed later if we need to do that. But again, once they're installed, they're pretty much installed and they're down. So we would come back, and if they need to be taken out, because so many residents supported them being put in, we would look for a very similar, you know, at least a two-thirds margin wanting them taken out to take them out. But we would also study that and look at those very, very closely to see if they're causing any other problems or making sure they're doing what they're intended to do. And the big thing I will give kudos to Adam in this particular case is one of the things we've seen is a back kind of story to speed humps that doesn't really get taken into account on the front end. Is usually the speed humps where they're installed next to somebody, everybody wants them until they're right in front of your house.
Yeah.
And the reason we don't recommend them on highly traveled roads, besides it just being a highly traveled road, obviously if there's a lot of vehicles on there, there's a reason there's a lot of vehicles on there. But if on a road where there's a lot of cut through traffic, if you're the house where there's one right in front of you, there's a lot of thump, 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 thump noise. So the more traffic there is, the more apt you are to get a complaint from the residents there. If you'll notice in your packets and when it goes to the full board as well, Adam actually has and required this as a part of the speed hump installation, for all the residents where the humps will be installed in front of their properties had to be in agreement and concurrence that the humps could be installed in front of their properties. So we have that in addition to the normal petition here. So we have that on the front end as well.
That's good. That's good. Thank you. Anything else you want to say about that?
No, ma'am.
All right. Item three, consideration of resolution 2021-138, a resolution declaring an existing section of right-of-way known as Simmons Ridge Drive, generally located east of South Carothers Road and north of Longpoint Way, as surplus.
So this is pretty simple. They platted property to us. They want to reconfigure it now and plat it a different way. And so to do that, we just got a declared surplus, and then we can deed it back to them. So our recommendation would be to move this to the new business section.
And can we have a map with it when we do that?
I can pull a map.
I want a map, but I'm sure
this is internal.
There actually is in the exhibit. He's bringing it up for you.
I saw that map. I mean,
overall, yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
We will include that.
Yeah, this is just internal.
Y'all gonna have to go old school because Simmons. Where's Simmons Ridge?
We will take care
of that.
That's
where
Pearl
lived.
And it is very much internal to their site, so.
Yeah. But just even something just to kind of.
We can do that.
We will do that.
Would be great.
Yes, because this doesn't help a whole lot if you actually want to locate it in the city, especially if the roads aren't even there yet.
Yeah. I mean, we always love a map in general, but they're going to be really helpful moving forward.
Yeah, we got you.
All right. Anything else you want to say about that?
No, ma'am.
All right. Item four, consideration of draft City of Franklin contract number 2021-0271, a professional services agreement with Ground Penetrating Radar Systems, LLC, for advanced underground utility investigations for the Liberty Pike Mallory Lane intersection improvements project at a cost of $44,250.
So this is something we're trying to be a little bit more proactive on, the design side of it. And a lot of times, roadway construction, the roadway is the easy part, the roadway design, the roadway construction. It's really trying to figure out the utilities. And what we're running into on a lot of projects is the locates that we're receiving are not accurate or are not good enough. And so this is kind of going above and beyond to really locate all the utilities in the right-of-way to have a better set of plans so that we can better coordinate construction instead of finding surprises during construction. And for example, one of the main issues out here is there's a gas line that is it's a polyethylene type pipe with no locate wire. So that the gas company can't even locate it. And so this will, again, allow us to really understand where those utilities are and make much better decisions on whether they need to be relocated or not. And I guess another example would be is sometimes we'll be moving $250,000 worth of water line that maybe we didn't need to move if we truly knew the location. So, and that's the case in this project, which is really what's making us want to go to this next effort of utility locates.
And the short story is when you don't want to find things in utilities, you don't want to accurately determine them when you're actually digging. That's the wrong time to find them. That's when everybody gets really frustrated. It gets very expensive. The more you can do and the more information you have on the front end, the better off we're all going to be, especially when it gets to construction.
That's good thinking.
It's a little more expensive on the front end, but especially in issues like this where we know it's going to be very complicated, it's worth the effort here.
Much better. Great. All right. Anything you want to say about that?
No, this has a map-esque, so we're good there.
Yeah, we like maps. Item five, consideration to grant water availability for 1200 Old Hillsboro Road, map 027, parcel 00500.
Good afternoon. This property is, let me do that. Thanks, Paul. So this property is located north of the city limits. It's at the intersection of Old Hillsboro Road and Hillsboro Road. The property is located in the northwest quadrant of that intersection. It's a mixed-use commercial development that's going in there. It's in our service area
although it is outside of the city limits. And they're requesting 4 2-inch meters and 1 1-inch meter. The benefit of this project is it'll allow us to loop some lines in that area that are currently dead ends and some infrastructure that needs to get replaced because it's fairly old up in that area. So you know where Barbara's is. It's a little bit to the east of that of Barbara's, restaurant. Yes. Okay. So
it's on the west side.
It's the west side of Hillsboro. So yeah. They've requested
I know.
Availability and the department is recommending availability.
Wow.
All right, and that. But it's outside of the city limits. Is it adjacent?
It is not adjacent to the city limits, but if you'll remember, we serve up into the grassland area for the water utility, so we serve a fairly large area that's outside of city limits. But it is established as the City of Franklin service area.
But what? There's a building there or no?
There's no building there.
Okay, because I was on the other side of the road where there is a building, so.
Yes, I think there's a doctor's office across the street, and this is in part going to be a doctor's office as well.
And it's toward Hillsboro Road from Barbara's or on the other side?
Toward Hillsboro Road from Barbara's.
Okay.
Yep.
All right.
If I remember correctly in some of the discussion we had, that some of the current service is... It's an understatement to say it's very inadequate, and it was.
Yes, sir. This will improve that area greatly. There's some service lines that extend down Old Hillsboro Road, a fairly extensive way, and this will have a great deal of improvement in that little intersection area.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mayor. Anytime you want to speak, would you please just speak out?
Don't.
We're going to have Kleenex at every station.
Item 6. Consideration of draft change order 8 to City of Franklin contract number 2017-0264 with Kiewit Infrastructure South Company for the Water Reclamation Facility Modifications and Expansion Project.
Hello, thank you. So as you know, as we go through projects, there are things that need to get modified in the field from time to time. The department in this contract set aside an owner's contingency of $4 million. This change order is for just over $1 million, which would leave just under $1 million left in the owner's contingency. And there's a number of different things that happened that relate to this this change order.
Isn't $1 million a lot for a change order?
Yes, ma'am. And there's been a number of changes that need to occur over time. And that's why we build in an owner's contingency into these larger projects, just to make sure as you get into site conditions, things are maybe not always accurately mapped and things of that nature. So we have to make adjustments in the field to keep the project going.
All right.
So may I suggest that moving forward in the description that $1 million is put in the description?
A summary of the the change, yes, ma'am.
Otherwise, it looks like no big deal. Then you're like, oh, wait a minute.
All right, anything else you want to say about that?
No, ma'am.
All right. Item 7, consideration of draft amendment 1 to City of Franklin contract number 2020-0278 with AECOM for pump station evaluation and WTP valve access.
So, in January, we entered into an agreement with AECOM, and part of that scope was to evaluate several lift stations within the city. In addition to that, AECOM was going to evaluate the access of several valves in the new water treatment plant. They're a little difficult for staff to access at this point, so they're looking at I wouldn't call it a scaffolding system, but a system to be able to get staff up there more safely. And what this, as they got into the preliminary design of it, they needed to dig in a little deeper, and this really will finalize that design to build the appropriate structures to be able to access those valves appropriately and safely.
Okay. Then that one done at the beginning?
The means to access those valves was through a chain at that point, and there's some mechanical issues that have occurred, and the ability to get up there and access them has been challenging because they're really high up and towards the ceiling.
Okay. Any questions?
Does that come off our million-dollar contingency, too?
Pardon me?
I said, does that come off our million-dollar contingency, too?
No, it's a different...
Different bucket?
Different bucket.
Well, this is the water treatment
yes.
plant, not the wastewater
yes,
or
sir.
Water reclamation.
Oh, sorry.
So this would be operations, right? Really?
How much did you say that would be?
$78,000, a little over $78,000.
It's in the item description. Or the...
It's a lot.
Report.
Okay, item 8. Consideration of draft change order 2 to City of Franklin contract number 2018-0226 with BLD services for cured in place piping pipe lining.
So BLD currently has a contract with the City of Franklin to do lining of sanitary sewer infrastructure, and the cured in place pipe lining is really, I guess a way to describe it is kind of inverting a sock into the pipe and curing it, and therefore you eliminate INI potential and things of that nature. It also provides some additional structure. When the contractor went in and did the replacement of a portion of the Spencer Creek line, which is downstream of this location, they identified some significant amount of infrastructure coming in further upstream. So they did a subsequent investigation and identified the boundaries of the area that they wanted to take care of. This can be accommodated in the existing budget, although we'll have to push off some other work, most likely, but we'll be able to stay within budget in terms of...
Do we have other areas that need this?
We tackle pipelining projects every year. Last year we did, I can't remember the number of miles of pipe, and this is actually a relatively large pipe, but we'll do... I apologize, I don't have the number off my head, but we did a number of miles last year, and we continue to do it. The idea is if you can line the pipe, the cost of doing that per foot is much cheaper than going in, digging down, and replacing the line. So this is a more cost-effective way in doing it if the line is a candidate for it. You have to have certain standards in order to be able to do those types of projects.
You have a way of examining the pipe.
Yes, ma'am.
And if you see the need for it, then you bring these socks in.
Correct. We'll run cameras down these lines. Depending on the size of the line, we'll have to hire a contractor to do that, which we had to do for this project.
Okay.
If you look at the cost to replace that section of line, it would be a little less than double the cost of lining the line. So it's really a cost-effective way.
Okay, so what is it now?
$479,000.
Total replacement is $849,000.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
And to answer your earlier question, yes, if you have pipes in the ground, INI is a problem if you have pipes in the ground. As pipes age, you're always going to get water getting into those pipes that you need to prevent.
So you make the whole thing sound very uninvasive, but, I mean, they're still going to have to, I mean, you can go look with the camera, but you're not going to be able to put the sock in that way, are you?
You can do it through an access point.
Oh,
oftentimes,
really?
You'll have to take the crown of a manhole off in order to get the equipment in there, but
sure.
It's far less invasive than...
Oh, great. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Item 9, consideration of retainage agreement for City of Franklin contract number 2021-0272. With Heron Construction for Southeast pilot plant and Red Wing reclaimed water booster station?
So Heron is currently, as the subject describes, they're building a pilot plant just north of Red Wing Farms subdivision, as well as a reclaimed water booster station. When the contract got bid, one of the front-end documents somehow got left out. We're not sure how. We thought we were good with it. But that portion of the front-end docs was the retainage agreement, which allows the city to withhold monies when the city pays the contractor on an invoice. And really what that does is it gives the city some leverage at the end of a project to provide for any corrections or issues that have come up during the construction process. So this is a typical document or a typical agreement that should have been built into the bid package, which unfortunately was left out. So we're catching up on that right now.
When was that done?
I don't recall the specific time in which it was bid. It was earlier this year.
This year?
Yes, ma'am. I think March time frame comes to mind, but
kind of recent.
Yes. March or April.
Okay.
I apologize, I don't have that date.
Can we also add a map to this just for reference for our, stop it, Jonathan. I'm trying to save you some trouble so people know what's what.
We need maps.
We've been dealing with all this and it's just.
Yeah. We thought we'd taken care of this. Didn't we think we'd ask for maps?
Yes, ma'am.
I will have it.
We thought we had.
Added.
Maps and aerial maps, so you can actually see landmarks. Not.
It's going to have to just be like part of the package.
I wanted to point out the availability in the grassland area that we spoke about earlier. We do not have aerial photography in that area, so I wanted to point that out.
Well, but you did have something that showed where it was, so that was very helpful.
Folks at Google can help us out with that.
Oh, yeah. I don't have your map.
All right. Any more comments on that?
No, ma'am.
All right. Item 10. Capital projects, dashboard, and status updates for October 2021. Are there any of these you'd like to discuss?
Are y'all going to surprise Margaret with her build, her bridge being done?
No, they're not. I'll tell you that.
I will tell you that when we do get it going, we will absolutely bring you out there.
Yes.
We will come get you and we will bring you out there. We will personally come and get you.
No telling where I'll be then.
We will come and get you. We will find you and we will bring you out there. The one update I did want to give is a correction, an update, not really a correction, but an update. It was the best information we had at the time as an update, though, is Mac Hatcher. So I wanted to give an update on that one because it was various information out there, and we helped to, well, I helped to give wrong information. New information we have now. Anyway, the last information we gave at CIC was that it was going to open this Sunday and with a ribbon cutting on the 4th of November. That is no longer the case. There were some delays that we heard not too long after the last CIC meeting that make that no longer the case. They have some small supply delays and some subcontractor delays on the issue that keep that project from wrapping up on that date. So they are still working on the project. The original contract end time on the date between TDOT and their contractor, their prime contractor, has always been November 30th of this year. That is still the case, so they have not extended the contract or changed it in any way, shape, or form. So they are still going with that date. So that is still the date they're giving out, is November 30th of this year.
When it will be open.
By that time, yes. So that's still the date they're working off of right now. We don't have an exact date yet, but I just wanted to let people know in this public meeting that it is not this weekend. So don't, Monday morning you're not going to be driving on it. Sunday you're not going to be driving on it. So just, you've heard it here. So apologize for the misinformation, and there's been some articles out there written saying that was a date. That's actually where I read it, was in an article. So that is not the case at this time.
Well, that had been information provided by TDOT at that time.
That's correct. That was the information we all had at the time, and we were all working off that information.
Everything changed.
It changed not too long after we announced it, which is, that's usually how it happens, but
yep.
We want to give you the latest information.
Hillsboro Road is wonderful. That intersection is just beautiful. I just like to ride around on it. Go around in a circle, round and round.
We'll be excited when you can ride around on it with, without all the barrels and with everything turned on and working.
Yeah. They don't bother me.
Okay. We'll let them know. They can leave a few out there for you. And I'll answer any questions you have.
Okay. Do you have any questions?
No, ma'am.
I think I've about asked out. Yeah. Just whenever you're ready to start on my projects, I'll be watching. But thank you for Franken Road. I'll tell you right now, if Franken Road hadn't been started, I would have had to run again. And you didn't want that, so.
Actually, we can stop it and get you to run again if you'd like.
No.
We can absolutely put a stop and get you to run again.
No, thank you.
I will give you a small update about your project. We actually have been meeting with Middle Tennessee Electric. We had had one issue that we have been working with them off and on about a utility relocation, which in the scheme of things sounds like a small issue because all the electric lines are overhead, and normally that would be a small issue. But we were going to need to acquire a...
It was going to be $2 million.
No, it actually it was not a cost. It was actually, for once, was not a cost issue. It was acquiring a Middle Tennessee Electric electric easement. They always require, when they change pole locations, a brand new easement from a property owner. Well, if you recall, there's a, right near that bridge, there's a condominium complex. And what we found out was that condominium complex would require, it would require to go to every one of the condominium.
It's across the street, though.
But we were going to relocate the utility lines across the street to tie in properly. And we were just going to barely go across that property. But because we were relocating a pole across the property, we were going to have to acquire a new easement across that property. And the way the property works out, at least the best we can tell, is we were going to have to actually go to each one of those individual unit owners to negotiate that individual easement. So that would have had to, however many unit owners, I think it's 27 unit owners. So we've been able to work with Middle Tennessee Electric to most likely work out a different route.
Okay.
So it will not force us to go through that whole process. So we've been able to work through a different route, which should hasten the process of right-of-way acquisition. So it will make, I know I know you don't trust us at this point on this project. we're trying to do our best to restore that trust. We're trying to make that faster. We only have to physically, at this point, acquire easements from two sets of people, and Middle Tennessee Electric has agreed, at least in email, to acquire the easements from the other set of folks that only require electric easements. And they have availability to do that very soon, is what they have told me in an email this morning.
Okay.
So as soon as we have that contract, and I'm working on that contract with them for relocation that I hope to have on the board agenda in December, we will begin working on those as soon as we get the appraisals in. As soon as those appraisals are in and we have closed those acquisitions, and they're very small acquisitions, for us, two property owners, for Middle Tennessee Electric, either one or two property owners, we should be ready to bid that, and that'll be a small project. And we will absolutely bring you back out for that.
Jonathan, I want this to be understood. I do trust you.
And I say that tongue in cheek. I know you do.
I know you do. Trust you. And I know you have a lot on your plate. I just felt that this was a project that could be done quickly and much less expensive. You know, with the way I do things.
Yes, ma'am.
I could have had it done in a week. And it wouldn't have looked very good, but at least people would have been able to cross the creek. And so, but I do trust you. I trust all of you, and I thank you for your work every day. You mean the world to this community, all of you, and I do thank you very, very much. And
thank
I've
you.
Appreciated you putting up with me through all this.
We'll put up with you even more. So, and I say that tongue in cheek for us for the trust issue, but we want to get it done. And as we dug into it, the reason it's taken further a little longer than we wanted to do it the right way and get it done in such a way that we didn't want to rip something out in the future and waste any taxpayer money.
Well, you've got a lot on your plate, and I appreciate that.
But
thank
we will
you.
We will get it done the right way, and we will bring you out for that ribbon cutting.
Yeah, I'll accept.
We might even try to slip a plaque in there or something with you. So we'll have to work. We'll see if the board will approve that for you. So
Call me when you pour the concrete. I might accidentally etch something in
there. There you go. Yeah,
we can do our Hollywood Walk of Fame and have Margaret's hands.
Yeah. We can make that happen. We can absolutely make that happen. It turns out we have some artistic eyes on the board member, on the board, so we can probably make something happen.
All right. Is there any other business from anybody? Is there a motion to adjourn? Oh, we can't
we don't
do
have
that.
To do that.
Yep, you're done.
Well, we adjourn.
Look at you. Make it happen.